name's William Jackman, and my great-great-grandfather came from England and moved to the United States, and I was born in Vermont in 1795, which would make me over 200 years old. I was born January the 23rd, 1795, and moving from Vermont, we eventually moved to New York area. And in the New York area, in about 1812, there was a war called the War of 1812, and hence the name, right? It was an odd war. It was between England and the United States, and France also got involved. It was over fishing rights and trade embargoes. It was kind of a silly war. It only lasted a few years, actually less than a few years. And in August 1814, I enlisted, and I spent 1 month in the military, almost exactly 30 days, which you were required to do right then. The war was coming to an end, so from August 1814 to September 1814, I fought under Elijah Kellogg in the New York militia. Didn't see a whole lot of action. At that time, there was just small skirmishes here and there. There was a peace treaty signed, and I believe it was November or December of 1814. And it actually went into effect sometime in January or February of 1815. When I came back from the war, I met a wonderful woman named Julia Ellis. We were married, and we had 7 wonderful children. And the children were, I'm going to have to count them on my fingers so I can remember all of their names. I had Rodney, William, James, Polly, Susan, Tryphena, and Lucinda. And Polly, unfortunately, she died at birth, but all the rest lived, and we eventually moved to Pennsylvania. Then my son Rodney moved to the Crystal Lake area to open up a dairy farm. And in 1845, we followed suit and moved to the Crystal Lake area and opened up a mercantile business. Along at that time, I became a postmaster, and I was the postmaster for many years in the Crystal Lake area. My son Rodney ran a successful dairy farm, and my son James also ran a successful dairy farm. James is buried here along with his wife Amanda. I also had a great granddaughter named Flora, who eventually married a gentleman named Colby, whose son opened started the Colby subdivision here in Crystal Lake. So that's my story. Anyone have any questions for me concerning my my exploits? And no, this is not from a war injury, it's just from old age.
So now, William and Julia are married.
Yes, I'm right here, and my wife's headstone is right here next to me. These are newer headstones. I'm not sure, one of our descendants must have put them in for us after the fact. But I wasn't originally buried in this cemetery either. I was moved here after the cemetery opened, as was my wife. She got the fever. That's where she passed away from, was the fever, typhoid fever. Anyone else have any other questions at all? No?
Are there a family still in the area?
Yes, as a matter of fact, a couple of my ancestors were, or ancestors, descendants, were here not that long ago. They were one of the first groups that talked to me today. I believe we determined it was my great-great grandson, Brett Hopkins. And then my great-great-granddaughter. So, anything, any other questions at all? These little bugs are just flying around me like crazy.
Okay, we can move on.
Okay. Thank you very much, folks. Enjoy the rest of your historical trip here today.
Please sit down and make yourself comfortable. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. How are you?
Good.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
It's only through the wonderful help of my neighbors and friends that I've been able to hear that has been thrust upon me. So thank you. Thank you so much for your support. I'm not here because of anything I have done, but for what my sons have done. I have this very strange honor of being the mother of the only two boys, or at least two brothers, who have died during World War II. There were two of the 22 young men who died from Crystal Lake during World War II. And while I am resting over there with my husband, my two sons are resting over there. I wanted to bring them home so that they could be with their family members and we could honor them the way they should be honored for their sacrifice. And I'm always very, very happy to talk about my two boys. Now, I did have five boys and I had a daughter too. But we're here to talk about that. Robert and Elmer. Robert's my youngest. He was born April 17th, 1923, and Elmer was born the same day, but only 13 years earlier, April 17th, 1910. And they entered the service the same year, and sadly enough, they died the same year. The Army informed me that Robert went missing in action on November 2nd, 1944, and I will never forget the day that they officially notified me of Elmer's death.
Mrs. Peters, the Secretary of the Army has asked me to express his deep regret that your son Elmer died in France on November 30th, 1944, as the result of wounds received in action the previous day while advancing with his unit in the Hargen Forest. The Secretary extends his deepest sympathy to you and your family in this time of your terrible sorrow.
Thank you. We brought our boys home in December of 1947. We requested that they would come home to be with our family. And the Army held them in New York over the holidays. And it was in January of 1948 that the boys finally came home. I won't forget that day. It was Saturday, January 9th. It was a 9:50 train right into Crystal Lake. And many family members and friends met them at the train and escorted their bodies to the Gilberts and Son funeral home, where they were waked until Sunday, January 10th. And January 10th at 12 o'clock, they were escorted to Emmanuel Lutheran Church. There was a service held for them. It was presided over by Reverend Gers, who was the same reverend who presided over my husband's funeral in 1943. My husband died October 26, 1943, the day after Elmer was inducted into the Army. Robert couldn't even be there because Robert was already at Fort Hood in Texas. And at that time, it was a wonderfully moving service to honor my two sons. The American Legion held a wonderful banquet afterwards to honor my sons and all the people who had come to honor their service to their country. So we as a family appreciated that, and we appreciate that you came here today to honor their sacrifice and to honor the sacrifice of the other 22 young men who died in Crystal Lake. So thank you for being here today for my sons. For that, I'll always be grateful. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I did want to say, I'm so sorry, I forgot. Sometimes in talking about my sons, I forget to mention a few things. When I was informed by the Army that Elmer had died on November 30th for wounds received in battle, that's when I became a Gold Star mother. I don't know if you're familiar with that organization. Up until that time, Emmanuel Lutheran Church and many people and businesses around Crystal Lake would fly a flag like this. The blue meant that there were members of the community or members of your family on active duty. If you received notification that one passed away, then you became, or then the star changed to gold, and you became a Gold Star mother. That organization began around World War I, when it was traditional to fly a gold flag to honor those that had died. And then around 1928, 25 mothers just decided that
It was a wonderful thing to support each other. They decided to make a national organization called American Gold Star Mothers, which has grown to thousands of mothers today, I'm sorry to say. And they support each other by attending anniversaries of deaths, parties, funeral service, memorial services, because only another mother who has gone through such a tragic loss would really be able to understand and be there for mothers who go through this today. So whenever you hear of Gold Star Mothers, please remember their sacrifice. Please remember the children who have died for our country, and say a prayer for them. Thank you.
I know during the Vietnam War, a friend of mine had two brothers active, and it was kind of where the mothers always hung those in the kitchen windows. It was very common to see those in kitchen windows. And you still will see those today. If you look, if you're not really knowing what they are, but we'll see them in. I'm always amazed how I usually see them in the kitchen window.
Kitchen.
Yeah.
Thank you for that information. Thank you.
Thank you. You're welcome.
Let's see. Good afternoon. We're right at noontime. If you would like to take a seat, you're welcome to do so. Good afternoon. I'm Alice Fitzgerald Palmer, and I'm here to share the story of my Crystal Lake Pioneer family, and especially about my brother, William. Now, our father was Daniel Fitzgerald, and our mother was Elizabeth or Eliza Fitzgerald, and they were born in Ireland in the 1830s. They got married in 1861 in Tipperary, Ireland, and shortly after, May 10th, 1862, you can see by the headstone, my brother William was born. And then I followed in 1865, and our parents had come, after being in Ireland there, to the United States to take advantage of the opportunities here. And they went to the New York State, and then to Detroit, Michigan, and then returned back to Ireland. And it was there that my mother gave birth to my three sisters, Blanche, Mary, and Anna, and also our youngest brother, Michael. Now imagine, they all came back to the United States. I just have this image of this large family coming back, six children. And they chose to come to Crystal Lake to farm. And my father bought a farm and was successful and eventually got to where he had no mortgage on his homestead. He and my mother raised the family, and in the 1920s, at the age of 85, each of them passed on. They're side by side next to my brothers, raised up, mother and father. Now, my sisters and I had to tend to a lot of chores at the farm. We did the sewing, the cooking, the never-ending chores. And perhaps it was because they were chores, our brother William didn't choose to come into the kitchen as much as we would have liked, although we tried to entice him in. Instead, he had quite a bit of fun with my father, went and farmed, but he mostly enjoyed hunting and fishing, and he did quite a bit of that. And perhaps that explains why he had a great fit of wanderlust. He was the Fitzgerald with a bad case of wanderlust. And so it was in Chicago he went in 1885, and enlisted with the U.S. Cavalry. And he went and served a 5-year term. He was mustered out in Montana, and when he was discharged, it was as a sergeant. Now, he did not come back to the farm and help his farm. He did not come back to the kitchen, certainly, and help us with the chores there. Instead, he stayed on with the military. He re-enlisted, only this time it was with Company C of the U.S. Infantry. And this was the 15th U.S. Infantry, in fact. And this was where a lot of men, boys, from the northern part of Illinois were accompanied. And he continued to serve in the military, in the infantry, keeping in mind the infantrymen had probably the hardest job of all because they were on foot. They had to carry their utensils and certainly carry their equipment, their weaponry. They did not have an easy time of it. But fortunately, my brother had a great deal of energy and courage. He continued on. He served another 5 years, and then he got mustered out. And this time, when he was discharged, it was as a private. And this was in Montana. However, he wanted to continue with the military, so very quickly thereafter, he re-enlisted. And actually, he re-enlisted up to 4 times. I find that pretty incredible. In any event, he became involved with the period of our history known as the Spanish-American War. And just a little history about this. Spain had territories overseas here, and they wanted to assert their power, but Cuba was one that wanted to assert its independence, and Spain didn't want anything to do with that. Now, the United States gave a bit of antagonism to that, and perhaps we were motivated. We had our own expansionist sentiment. We had our eyes on some of those territories of Spain. They included Cuba, Puerto Rico, Guam, the Caroline Islands, perhaps others. In any event, the Spanish authorities allowed for the USS Maine, our ship, to be attacked. And it was in part because of that that the United States declared war against Spain. Now, this occurred in April 1898, and there was only 109 days of fighting hostilities, and then it ended in August 1898. And in part because of our Secretary of the Navy, Teddy Roosevelt, who you probably know of in other offices, and he joined with the forces to go with Cuban forces to fight against Spain. And so it was that Cuba became independent. And there was a Treaty of Paris signed in December 1898 that gave the United States rights to the formerly Spanish-controlled territories. Now, my brother Will had re-enlisted, and he chose to fight in Cuba, and he was involved in the fighting, but was eventually sent to the Philippines to quell the Philippine insurgencies against the American forces asserting their control. Keeping in mind, when a treaty is signed, you still have to execute it, and there may be some forces that are not quite satisfied with this. Now, the infantry unit that my brother had joined subsequently went on to California and built the Presidio. Now, we heard word quite in a different fashion than you would today, because we didn't have things like the newspaper like you have today. We didn't have the internet, certainly, or the telephone. And so we relied on letter, perhaps by the Pony Express. Came to us, we got a letter from my brother Will that he had been in Arizona. So that's what we were thinking. He's in Arizona. Unfortunately, we learned differently. And so in the fall of 1900, we learned that he had actually been killed September 17th, 1900. And so he was buried here in Union Cemetery, here with the Fitzgerald family plot. Now, I'd like to note that there was a special dress that the infantry wore, and I have a picture from the United States infantry, and you're welcome to take it and pass it on after you look at it. Please take it. And it was also fortunate that my mother was able to apply for a dependent mother's pension, and she applied and did receive pension. So you're welcome to look at this if you like. I think it's interesting how the processing had to go through. She actually had to hire an attorney to apply for this pension. Now, September 1900 was a special month for me. Of course, I was sad to learn of my brother's passing on. But it was also the month that I got married to my husband, Frank Palmer. And he was the grandson of Colonel Palmer, Colonel Palmer's house being still here in Crystal Lake. And we lived until the 1920s. I lived until 82 years of age. And I was buried by the side of my husband over in the Palmer plot here in Union Cemetery also. So I hope I've helped to give you a sense of what the pioneer families had to endure as they came and farmed the land, and especially what our men sacrificed on behalf of our country. Hope you enjoy the rest of your tour here at the Union Cemetery. Any questions or comments? Gladstone especially.
Mm-hmm. I'm Albert Dilley.
Sure.
I was born in 1848 in Pennsylvania, and I moved to a farm up near Terracotta in when I was 4 years old. I lived with my parents until I actually joined the Army in 1865. I lied to the Army and I said I was 18, but I was actually 16 years old. And in February of 1865, I joined the I Company, the 147th Illinois Infantry. My service in the Army was just about a year, and it was all pretty much in Georgia, where we did action against guerrillas and we did occupational duties. What I didn't know at the same time that I was in Georgia, my brother had been captured and he was actually a prisoner of war at the Andersonville prison. He survived. And then a few years before my death, I actually returned to Georgia and I visited the Georgia battlefields and I actually visited the Andersonville prison for the first time. After my Army service, I married Mary, and I was happily married to her for 68 years. Mary was a teacher in the area, one of the pioneer schools. And we had moved all over in the northern Illinois area. I had a number of professions. Most notably, I was the coal station operator nighttime for the Northwestern Railroad in Ridgefield for a number of years, and I also worked at a cheese factory in Lombard. Finally, in 1890, I returned to Crystal Lake and I became a contractor and I built a number of buildings throughout town, and actually a couple of them are still standing, the Whitty Building over on Beardsley and Main Street, and the old St. Paul's Church, which is on Ellsworth and Sherman. Those are both concrete block buildings. And I was a contractor for a number of years, and then finally I retired and moved in with my daughter and her husband, at which time I took the easy life and became had a vegetable garden and I grew melons. My big claim to fame is I was the last surviving member of the Nunday Post of the Grand Army of the Republic. The post was formed close after the end of the Civil War and actually survived until about 1922, and at which time the American Legion took over the responsibilities. Our legacy today is to the Memorial Day parade we have in Crystal Lake and the ceremony we have here at the cemetery at our statue. Disbanded our post, the American Legion recognized my comrades and myself until my passing in 1938. So, are there any questions? Bob is our resident historian on the Grand Army of the Republic, but I just wanted to show you, here's an actual membership medal. And you'll note that it's very similar to the Congressional Medal of Honor. And there's now legislation on that membership medals cannot resemble military medals due to this. And there's a picture of it in your program as well. Mm-hmm. Any questions?
Can you tell us about the headstone and the tree?
Can I tell you about the headstone and the tree? I can tell you that it would appear this tree has grown into the headstone. And I believe they were actually placed at all at the same time. Margaret was my daughter, and she passed in 1967. And I believe Mary's mother and father are the Lovelaces. Margaret purchased these all. These were placed around the same time, and this is almost 30 years later. Mm-hmm. descendants in the area still. Yes, I believe there are some Davises still in the area. But, you know, Mary left the legacy of actually educating children in the area.
It's interesting that your brother survived Andersonville, because
yes,
a lot of people did not survive Andersonville.
Correct. He was actually only, Andersonville, as it's known, was actually not open very long. It was roughly about a year that it was open, and it was, the main cause of the issue was simply because the Confederacy couldn't feed the soldiers properly, and the environment they placed them in. And what really caused the creation of the prison itself was, earlier throughout the war there was a common policy of exchange, and this was actually the first time that a prison like this had been built in the United States. Prisoners would be exchanged and or paroled, and the prisoner would be sign an oath saying, I will not rise against the Confederacy, and you know, obviously many times they went back to the army and returned. This prison was created, and at that time it was late in the war, the Confederacy had limited resources, the easiest solution for them was just to build a stockade. It had a stream running through it, and they felt that was sufficient water, and there wasn't enough food, and then the prisoners themselves had created internal, I can only describe them as gangs, and the ones by the water would control it, and obviously the ones where the water came into the camp were there in the best position because they got the clean water, and then they put down. So it was really horrible conditions for disease, and tight quarters. A number of people were held there, and limited food resources, and it was just not good conditions, and that's why the great number of soldiers died there. It's said that I believe of all the prisoners, of all the Civil War dead, this is like 10% of all the American, the Northern troops, 10% of the soldiers passed were from Andersonville. Of course, there were camps of this nature on the northern side, but when you're the victor, you get to control the history, right?
Right.
Now, Andersonville actually still exists today, and it's actually the home of the National Prisoner of War Museum, which traces all prisoners held during wartime. And then there's actually the site of the prison itself, and then there's a national cemetery there as well.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
My name is Victoria Booth Short, and I'm here to speak about my father, Captain Herbert Willoughby, Marine Junior, Captain in the United States Air Force. Now, my little background: my great-grandfather Ernest Booth, who is actually buried here, along with two of his children and his wife. He was born in England, and he moved here in around 1900 to Chicago, and eventually to Crystal Lake, where he and his wife became actively involved in Crystal Lake social scene. Now, as a side note of interest, my great-grandfather, 1916, swapped houses with Alva Roebuck, who you probably recognize as one of the founders of Sears and Roebuck, with a house he owned in Park Ridge. But the house that is here in Crystal Lake is available for tours, and it's at 270 Woodstock Street. My great-grandfather was also a personal friend with Mr. Sears, and Mr. Sears' son, Wesley, and my grandfather spent a great deal of time at the Sears' home in Gages Lake. Now, also, in 1921, my great-grandfather moved his family from Crystal Lake to Sarasota, Florida, where my father was born on October 19, 1930. Now, my father was very proud of his father's service as a captain in the Army Air Corps in World War II. In high school, that's when he came to the decision that he would like to enter the Air Force and become a pilot. He wanted the best education, so, which means West Point. And having survived the Beast Barrack, as they call it, in Cleve year, my My father also made the wrestling team and was in the glee club. He also enjoyed history and he loved to speak German. My father married Nancy Penrose on August 21st, 1955. They had two children, myself, of course, and my older brother, Herbert Willoughby Booth, Jr. Now, my brother was 19 months old, and I was just a few days old when my father left for Vietnam, so unfortunately I never got to know him. Now, for you history buffs who like detail, here's a little bit of detail of his mission in Vietnam. On October 13th, 1961, a formerly top-secret document was sent from the White House directing the Air Force to deploy the first detachment of Jungle Gym Air Commandos to Vietnam. This deployment was named Farmgate and was designated Detachment 2A, the first Air Commando group in Vietnam. From this detachment was the first use of the Air Force's forward air controllers using the call sign Dora Korn. These FACs were there to give cover to ground crews and to fly low over the trails and battlefields. FAC marked targets with smoke rockets or grenades, performed and directed airstrikes upon the enemy, and led rescue missions while enduring fire, hazardous weather, and hostile terrain. Now, they were there also to train the Vietnam civilians to help defeat the Viet Cong. Now, my father was an early volunteer for this program, and the plane he was flying, it's formerly known as the L-28 Helio Super Courier. This aircraft was designed for football field takeoff and landings and close in-fire direction. And my father knew this assignment was high risk, but he loved to be on the cutting edge of what was happening. Now, this particular tour deferred a German attaché assignment, which he had competed for heavily. On October 15th in 1962, he was flying the U-10A into harm's way with Captain Terry D. Cordell, a U.S. Army Special Forces, and Combat Air Controller T. Sergeant Richard L. Fox when they took heavy fire, and unfortunately they went down to instant death in the Dar Lạt province of South Vietnam. Now, due to that heavy fire from the Viet Cong, their bodies were unable to be rescued until the following day, and which also put the rescuers in harm's way, but fortunately, rescuers were able to do their job and they got out alive. Now, my father was shot down just 4 days before his 32nd birthday, and per his wishes, his ashes were scattered over the Gulf of Mexico. And also per family wishes, there is a marker here with his name on it representing the family. Now, I'd like to share what one of his West Point classmates said about my father. Bill Schultz said, "It's stunning to relive the memory of Bill's death. He was one of West Point's best men. He was our class's second combat death. His courage, his hero's death, his distinguished flying cross lives on to inspire us all." And if you don't mind, I'd like to share a couple messages that were left on the Vietnam Wall Memorial in D.C. This is from Bill Gallenstein, a United States Air Force veteran from Florida, May 4th, 2007. "A very proud, cold United States Air Force veteran remembers you on this day. May God bless you and your family always. I salute you and thank you. We lived in Sarasota. What a beautiful place." And then also from Manny G., a fellow veteran, 1969-1970, from Union Gap, Washington, October 15th, 2007. "Peace and condolences to family and friends. You are remembered," by William Shakespeare. "He which hath no stomach to this fight, let him depart. But we in it shall be remembered. We few, we happy, we band of brothers. For he today that sheds his blood with me shall always be my brother. Rest in peace, brave soldier, and you have not been forgotten. May God bless you for your sacrifice."
Thank you.
All right, thank you for stopping by.
Thank you. If anyone like to use them, feel free.
Get that out of your way. I'm going to take a picture over my shoulder.
All right, my name's Lieutenant William Chandler Peterson, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself today. I was born Christmas Eve back in 1894. This is where I laid to rest. Born Christmas Eve, I'd like to think I was probably the best Christmas parent Christmas present my parents ever received. I lived most of my life in Crystal Lake. I attended and graduated Crystal Lake High School back in 1912. It's now referred to as Crystal Lake Central High School. 4 years later, I graduated from the University of Illinois. I obtained a degree in architecture. Architecture was my passion at that point. One of the things that really inspired me about architecture is the fact that you can sit at a table with a blank sheet of paper and from your mind create a structure. And once that structure, the design is completed, that's turned over to a carpenter and they're able to actually build, you know, what you create in your mind. I was truly inspired by that. Now, right out of college, I obtained a job with a terracotta company. Because back in the early 1900s, terracotta, that was a thriving industry back then. But that wasn't what I enjoyed doing. So it was a short time after that I obtained a job with the Leonard Construction Company of Chicago as an architect. So I was able to do what I loved. Now back in August of 1917, I then was sent to Fort Sheridan for second officer's training. I was activated and had to do my part in the World War. So I spent 6 months at Fort Sheridan. In January of 1918, I was sent to France. It was now time for me to go to war. Now, one of the things I remember about this initial process of being sent to France was most of my life was spent between Chicago and Crystal Lake. So what I was able to see was very limited between those two points. And now I'm being sent to the East Coast to board a ship to go to France. So I was able to see a little bit more of the United States that I had never seen before, and I was very impressed with that. So I board the ship, cross the ocean, and I arrive in England. One of the things that impressed me the most about England was the countryside. You would travel through the countryside, and you would see hedges all along the roadway, all along the fields, and all of the hedges were just completely well kept. I was amazed at that. It was almost as if England was, you know, someone's home and they were welcoming you to their home, the way they took great care of that country. Now, the city streets were beautiful. And the homes, architecturally looking at the homes, they were very well built mostly of brick, which was very impressive back then. Now, looking back at all this, you look at the fact that the countrysides were beautiful, the hedges were completely well kept, the streets were beautiful and the homes were beautiful. You literally had to stop yourself and remind yourself that this country was at war. You would never have known that. So I spent the short time in England. We crossed the channel into France. Now, once in France, I will say I completely enjoyed the French food. It was wonderful. And I will say that as a soldier for the United States military, walking through France, I was amazed at the support that the French people had given us. You'd walk through the towns and you would see the United States flag hanging from every balcony, from every window. The French people were so appreciative of having the U.S. military there to help them fight this war. So as a soldier, that meant a lot to us to see that they appreciated our efforts. Now, with the military, you know, being across seas, the news, you didn't hear too much what was going on in the States. Now, we were able to get editions of the Chicago Tribune and the New York Herald. But by the time we received those foreign editions, the news wasn't news anymore. And there were times we would hear stuff word of mouth from other soldiers before we'd ever read about it in the paper. So that was a little bit difficult. One of the things that France wasn't able to provide to us was, back in the States, I enjoyed a good picture show. Whether I'd be with my family or my friends, we would always go see a good picture show. And in France, the picture shows, you'd only see them on Saturdays and Sundays. And being in the military, you would seldom ever be able to go. But the one thing that impressed me the most about France was the architecture, the homes. Now keep in mind, I attended the University of Illinois, got my degree in architecture. But all that training, all that schooling that I received was through textbooks. And the textbooks we received back then, you know, wasn't all that detailed. The quality was relatively poor. If you had any type of diagrams, they may have been drawn freehand. If there was a picture, the quality of the picture was poor. Now that I was able to compare it standing there in France. So there I am in school studying buildings, and within 2 years, I'm literally standing in front of those same buildings in France that I studied. I was completely impressed by that fact. Now on June 6, 1918, I was sent to take place in the Battle of Chateau Thierry. Battle of Chateau Thierry was a major battle in World War I because it was considered the Germans' final offensive in the River Marne. So June 6th, as a lieutenant, I took my troops into that battle. On June 7th, I died. 1 day later. There's no record of what my injuries were sustained, you know, as far as what type of fatal injuries I sustained. There's no record. My parents did receive word of my passing, and within a month, the University of Illinois was building a new stadium on the grounds. And in that stadium, they had 183 columns, one column for every alumni killed in World War I. And one of those columns was dedicated in my honor. I received the Silver Cross for Valor from the government as a result of my efforts. It was about 2 years later, that my mother attended the University of Illinois for a tree planting ceremony. So I was, obviously, it was very special to know that my mother was able to attend that ceremony, dedicating that tree in my honor. I was very impressed with that. And it was a year later after that, 3 years after my death, that my body arrived back in Crystal Lake. Once my body arrived back in Crystal Lake, it laid in state for 2 days at the gymnasium at the high school. Now my family has a deep, rich history in the Crystal Lake area. We own many acres of land over by what is First Congregational Church right now. I'm surrounded by my family. I have my father, Frederick Peterson, my mother, Emma Peterson, and siblings amongst me. I have more relatives here, aunts and uncles, grandparents. 1 street over you have Peterson Parkway. Peterson Parkway is named after my family. That brown house right there with the green roof that you see across the street, my uncle built that house, moved into it in 1906. And then down the street at Oak Street, you have what's the Park District, the building they own now, that used to be the American Legion. That American Legion was named after and dedicated in my honor. That's pretty much been my life history. 23 years short, but a lot that went on during that time. Does anybody have any questions that I can hopefully answer?
Could you tell us about the uniform and some of the things you have up here?
The uniforms here are authentic from World War I, from the McHenry County Historical Society. You have, you know, the helmet, you have a shell casing from some artillery. There's a gas mask on the far left. So those are all authentic items from the McHenry County Historical Society. Any other questions anyone may have? Okay, there's one thing I will tell you. The Crystal Lake Historical Society puts this event on every year. You have 6 people that you've met today that you didn't know anything about before you got here. And it's through the Crystal Lake Historical Society's efforts, because of their efforts, you now know about our efforts. So without their support, you wouldn't know anything about us. So as you leave today, if you are kindly able to empty your pockets and help them out, that would be greatly appreciated. Okay? Any other questions I can try and answer for anyone? I appreciate you coming out today. Hopefully you enjoyed your time and got to know a little bit more about our past here on Crystal Lake. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
We look over here. Thank you for coming. And we look over here. This monument. You can see that the figure at the top is missing. What happened was it was put up in 1888. It was a zinc statue made of zinc. And over the years, in 2006, they decided that because he was leaning pretty far backwards, looked like he was going to fall over on his back, that this needed a lot of repair. So in order to save the statue, they took the top off, and now they're collecting money, and now they'll be working on the base of the statue. So if you want to contribute to that, that's wonderful, that $25,000 is needed. And And then you can, the little bricks there, you see the bricks, you can have a name put on those bricks for $150.
Thank you very much.
Either a name of someone in your family that was in the service, anything. And so I believe there's a number in here you can call. Now, the Union Cemetery itself, back in. Yes. Amy, he was holding a gun that seemed to be missing. Yeah, they'll replace that. I don't know what over the years what happened to it, but it was missing. There were two separate communities here. Down by the train station, it was known as Nunday. Up on Virginia Avenue, across from McCormick Park, that was called downtown Crystal Lake. And the two communities decided at one time that Lake Avenue Cemetery, the burial place that they were using, was filling up. So they formed committees for both communities, and they bought this property here, Union Cemetery. They bought it from Mr. Herbert, 10 acres for $1,500. And the cemetery was opened in 1888. The statue went up in 1889.
Maureen, is the base all set now?
No, they have to do some work on the base, especially the bottom part, because take a look at its cracked.
Oh, so otherwise it just looks great.
They need to do a little work on that bottom part.
Okay. Sorry.
That's okay. Any questions, just interrupt me. Now, the cemetery is great because it's laid out in plots, and you've got alleyways. I call it an alleyway. You've got walkways through so that you don't have to step. It's very easy to go through the cemetery. You don't have to step in somebody's grave, which is not. Most people don't like to do that. So it's a beautiful cemetery. And if you'd like to follow me, we'll go to our first grave. He's a gentleman from the War of 1812. And all these graves are people that were in one war or another. We want to honor our veterans and their families and make you aware of the sacrifices that they made. And so we will go this direction. Just follow me.